Beta Kappa for the opportunity. Yesterday I learned about I learned that the intuitive controlling power can be different with the real confirming power. So it is important to calculate the confirming power, maybe by using Excel in the computer. And the confirming power itself, we can divide the false positive divided to the true positive. And the false positive is more important to calculate the confirming power. Thank you.
Yeah.
Because we have learned many recipes.
Thank you, Dr. Ika. Continue to the previous one that he said confirming power that we learned yesterday. In this afternoon, we learned about probability. Prof. Jet told that human brain is a very bad computer. I agree. Especially in the afternoon session. I feel that it's difficult to me to understand about how to calculate the probability, but by the case that we remember all about the Bishop case, so we can imagine how to make the probability, and we found out that the prevalence is the factor that influence the probability.
So you mean that the prevalence influence the positive probability value?
Yes.
Yes.
Positive.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Daya.
Professor.
Yeah.
You never looked at us.
Never looked
at us.
I'm not looking. Sorry.
So, and when she speaks.
Yeah.
One job.
One job.
One job.
Yeah. Okay.
Can please? And look at this from time to time.
Yeah.
We are also.
It is nice to understand.
How much should that be?
Computing power is used to evaluate how much an argument can ask toward or away from a suspicious disease.
Thank you.
Hey, go to the wall.
Go to the wall.
No, yeah, just speak there so I cannot understand.
Yesterday we learned that there's an application that is really cool to teach students and also to guide us about many symptoms that or a disease that has several symptoms, then each symptoms we can have the how much sensitivity and also the confirming power and also the excluding power. And the application called Kamisa. Kamisa, right? And we have to be careful that this software may not be fall into a orang pintar, so they can use to treat the wrong patient.
Thank you for the Mulan.
Yeah. I can say something.
Yeah.
So, saya bisa bicara bahasa Indonesia. Download aplikasi. I saw that on the car this morning. So Indonesian is download aplikasi. Very simple, isn't it?
Dr.
Musi,
please,
give
a brief summary about what.
Thank you. Yesterday, I learned and know about Kamisa.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Kamisa, like, we can use like play a game.
Play
a
game.
Play
a game.
Play a game.
And do you want to use it in your daily practice?
Yes, of course. For infection cases.
Okay. Brother Pumpkin.
Yes. I learned about spit.
Mm-hmm.
And what's that? About the last, the
yesterday.
It's American.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Palki. Now we want to hear from the CDB question about yesterday's customers.
Okay. I'm sorry, I was late yesterday, and I only followed the second session. So I didn't get the PPC, so took calculus PPC. But because I met I feel difficult to calculate and to implement it in daily practice. Because this day I can more lesson.
Yeah. So don't worry, I should let yesterday.
I also learned about the PPV, and I learned that PPV is influenced by the prevalence. So that PPV can be measured, can be calculated by two ways. The first one is that the true positive divided by the whole positive result, and the second one is when you calculate the prevalence into it by maybe sensitivity multiplied by prevalence divided by it, the sensitivity multiplied by prevalence multiplied by it is hard to explain, but when you get the right corner, so the negative. Yeah, it's hard to explain. It's 1 minus prevalence multiplied by, if I don't get it wrong, 1 minus the true the false positive. Right? I don't know. Maybe I will look it again, but I have a rough diagrams in my head, but I still not 100% sure about it.
Okay. Okay, thank you,
Dr. Christine. Yesterday I learned that odd ratio is actually the sum up of the confirming power and the excluding power, but in log. I was surprised also.
Thank you. I learned yesterday. Things new for me to calculate positive predictive value with taking our suspicion into account. If we are doing something in community, I think not in the research setting. If the research setting in lab, maybe we can use the usual equation, but if we are doing diagnostic tests in the community, like in yesterday's case in Como and with Bishop and Extra, we take our suspicion into the equation.
Okay, yeah. Yes,
again, in one sentence.
Which one? I learned this day, and I'm please pardon me if I'm wrong,
is that if we want to calculate positive predictive value in community setting, in the field setting, we should take our suspicion based on prevalence, based on the occupation of the patient and the community into account.
Yes.
That's all?
And yourself.
I learned about the sensitivity and specificity of the test and how the positivity of the test will influence, how much the positivity of the test will influence that the patient will develop or will have the disease. So that we count about the for clinician, it is important to count the positive predictive value. How much is the patient with test positive will get the disease? So we learned about that, and we also learned that the positive predictive value will be influenced by the prevalence of the population. And the test itself, sensitivity and specificity, is more constant. It doesn't change by the population or by the risk for developed disease in the population, but the positive predictive value is much more influenced by the prevalence. That's what I learned.
So we have to go to June. So we could see that the odds ratio was the same as the sum. But if you know if it is by log the same as the sum, with the original numbers it should be the same as the product, as the multiplication. So if you look into this multiplied by this, you have also the same. Simple mathematics.
Okay, you say if we multiply the complement and x to the power, then what we find?
The odds ratio.
The odds ratio.
Yeah, you see the same. By multiplication. Understand what is behind, but the students we do very simple, much more simple things. But you have to know at least if they ask you a question, you could say, good question, I will answer this in private after the course. Never answer good questions in the course with students, because then it becomes a one-to-one. Only the intelligent student, he asks you a very intelligent question. And if you go to that question, all the others, they say, well, what is this, what is this? I don't know if you were there with Marlene Boulard when that happened, no?
No.
What's his name, your most famous, best scrum student, I forgot.
The second scrum.
Yeah, but the man with whom we always sat together, I just can't find his name, the big one. The man who defied the professor.
Jared.
Yeah, Jared. Jarir asked, you know Jarir? Jarir asked a very intelligent question to the professor. Yeah? And she was very delighted. So she started to explain to Jarir. And we were looking at each other because nobody understood what was going on. And it went on for a quarter of an hour. Quarter of an hour, I understood, but no single student understood. Never do that. Never do that. That's very bad. Good questions, you say, hey, very interesting. Okay, we discuss that afterwards. Now this one I thought was feasible for every, for us. It's your question, or your remark. Now where does this lock come from? This comes from the discussion with one of the most famous Belgians. He is the man of Janssen Pharmaceutics. You know Janssen Pharmaceutics, Imodium, Loperamide, everything which is in psychiatry, yeah, all these, he invented with his team. So one day he came to me for a shot of yellow fever vaccination. And then he was with an assistant and he said, Jeff, can you show me Kabisa? So he showed him Kabisa because he heard about it. And then when he had seen it, he said, this is completely wrong. Like that. Jeff, you are completely wrong. I said, Mr. Janssen, why is this completely wrong? He said, we humans, we never multiply. Multiplication is something new that's very difficult to do. Even the Greek and the Romans could not multiply. Because for multiplication, you need the number zero. When you go to fundamental mathematics, without zero, you cannot multiply. Yeah. And who invented the zero? Arabs. Arabs invented the zero. It was one of the most important inventions in human history is the zero. So I said with them, and then we discussed for 2 hours. He said, no, we never multiply. Also, we never think in numbers like that. He said, we think in categories. And then he explained how they did with experiments with rats and so on and so on. It was extremely interesting. But then at the end, I said, so, Dr. Janssen, how do you multiply categories? And that's not my problem, that's your problem. So I went home, I said, yeah, what should we do? Destroy Kabisa, or what should we do? And then in the night I came back to secondary school, where they taught us that 3 centuries ago they had problems with calculation of the parallax of the stars. And at that moment they invented logarithms to be able to add instead of multiply. And I said, my God, we can also go for logarithms. And then we invented all these simple things, and then we put it in categories, weak, good, strong, very strong. And that is what you have to teach to your students. Don't teach all these rubbish with all these you teach simple things, simple, weak. I teach this course also to nurses in Africa. You can teach this to nurses in Africa, where you just teach what they need for good decisions. With the same system as this, but reduced to very simple things, weak, yeah. So, okay, so just thanks for your remark. Now we are on the Excel, this is a small thing. Because we were speaking now about positive predictive value. Listen to me, listen. It's unbelievable what an attraction such a screen of a computer has for human beings. Yeah. Like you say, David Hume, okay. Actually, the computer screen is more attractive than a David Hume. You speak about positive predictive value. In clinic, you don't speak about it. You don't speak about prevalence. You speak about suspicion. Because your patient is not population, he's a patient. Suspicion. And then from suspicion, you go to certainty. Which degree of certainty did he reach? Now the question is, you should also see what the degree of certainty is after a negative test. Yeah. And let me show, try to show. in the original one field, what would be, so this is HIV, simple one. My question is, what is this? What is the certainty in reach after a negative test? Work it out. This is the average. What is the certainty after a negative test?
Thank you.
What did you do for retention?
We have 100%.
You don't have?
Yeah.
For fever?
Kibush.
You didn't do?
No, no.
What did you do?
Kibush. Kibush.
That's not true. You don't have always givers. You have givers in 30 to 50%. So that's give it. And then false positives for givers.
What?
They
look at this table.
One.
Even it's not one, it's less than one. Givers is quite rare. So we put it 0. Then the surgeons, the cardiologists and the ophthalmologists. Retention, you did? Fever, you did?
Retention, yeah.
Retention. Okay, how much?
60.
False positives?
10.
10?
Positives.
It means in your waiting room, 1 out of 10 patients has got a retention. Perhaps you are a geriatrician, gerontologist. You work with people older than 80 years old. 80 years old. Then you have retention, 1 in 10. But not in children like this. Less than 1. But that's it. Then, part of this retention. Fever, we have no fever. How much?
Just the suspicious, the prevalence.
No, not prevalence.
Or the sensitivity, 70.
70. That's too high.
Yes, 50.
50. Then the false positives?
70. 7.
7.
30.
Yeah, 40.
Okay, so we have retention, fever, givers, contact.
Yeah.
How much?
80.
80. False positives?
10.
10. Yes. Then, do you believe this?
Yes.
How much?
80.
False positives?
2.
Maybe more. 5 years old and he has got BCG. No, not 50, because it goes down with the age.
So 40.
No, even less.
20.
Now we link all this because it's not linked yet. So I link this.
Number 2.
Suspicion of heat was this one. This suspicion of fever. Heat was this one. Then you know fever was negative. So this suspicion. The threshold for POTS, what would be the threshold for you to treat someone for POTS?
How many kind of
threshold? How much?
90%?
No, threshold for POTS. Can you do that? And then, because this then can make a nice graph, insert a graph and make a light graph like that, and then we'll see how it evolves. So, folks, try this out. Move. Thank you. Never, never.
Okay.
Because then you have to say no gibbers, no then the no gibbers is negative. So then it means that there is a gibbers.
Yeah.
Understand? Don't do that.
But
what is nice here, so I, because we do not do let me see what we can put in more. This is too specific to play the pulse disease. Let me see what's in the pulse disease. Say there is no outward behavior, for instance, or motion of rush, and I can say in physical action there are limitations, for instance. No, we do that. And then you can see when you put, we made a graph, as you have a graph now, we made a graph, but in this graph, you see the six most probable diseases, how they evolve in with the different findings. See, so this is not a simple graph, it is a complex graph where you see already a lot of, you see for all these diseases you see what it makes, and now with these computations you see that the pneumonia went up a lot. So this is, you can also, you can add the laboratory, you can say the sedimentation rate is very high. Yeah, it's high. And you can see what it makes to this disease. You can also look for all arguments if you don't want to. You can do an imaging, you can say there is an X-ray, and on the X-ray you can see the local observation and you are graph now, you see only you see how it is. So this is the expert. I propose you to try it out. You can, yeah, what is nice also, but now it's already you can go to the PowerPoint. There are no remembering. Normally, at a certain moment, you would do the power table and it will give you all the interesting elements that remain in this consultation. You will say, yeah, you can look for this, for this, for that. Let's let me try again. So if we go again, or we say child, and then we say with the history of fever or radicular, for instance, and for instance with cough. And then you, oh, coma. then you ask for the power thing. And we give you, for all diseases that remain, important diseases, we will give you what remains to be done. Yeah, very interesting. For as an aid, when you have a case, and you say this and this and this, what could be done? Then we will give you all this. Okay? So try the expert.
Thank you.